Hey, good morning, everybody. It is great to have you here in person, and it's great to have all you guys online, so welcome. I hope you're saying hi to each other online, because what a great platform that is to be able to do that and invite people in. Right now, you can invite somebody in. You can message that to Facebook or, I think, LinkedIn and those kinds of things, and you can invite your friends in right now. Tell them where you're at. So why don't you stay with us if you're here. If you're home, you can stay with us as well. We're going to sing together.
Lay your glory fills my
Well, hey, those of you here, you can take a seat for a minute. And those of you who are online, you're probably already sitting on the couch with your feet up and in your pajamas still. But we are so grateful that you're here with us. So, hey, we have a blood drive that's coming up, and I hope you'll jump online. You can get to that from our website, and that link is right there on the tab up there. You guys can find it easy, too, and you can register to give blood. And every time you give blood, that has the potential of saving 3 lives. That's pretty amazing. So make sure you sign up. Let's fill them all up this time. And if you do give blood, you know what? You give blood, I think it's like 50 days. After 50 days, you give blood again. So we try to space them out so that if you give blood, you can give blood at every blood drive that we do. So we're trying to do about 4, maybe even 5 a year kind of thing. So jump on there and sign up to give blood. If you are online with us, or even if you're here in person, there's the tabs up there, and obviously there's a connection card. Every week we say, hey, why don't you just fill it out? Let us know you're there with us, whether it's in person or online. Also is a great place to just share you got a prayer request, and we can be praying for you. So put that up there. If you got kids, you want to share that kids tab out, so not only enjoy it with your kids, but share that with friends of yours that have kids, and just say, hey, there's some really great videos, and they can watch that anytime during the week. So just click on those things. If you'd like to give to this ministry, there's a lot of ways to give. We have the envelopes right here if you're in person, or if you're in the area, you can always drive by. There's envelopes out there that can be mailed in anytime. But the best way is secure give, and it really is. It's a neat way. You can set up for auto give, or you can text to give, and that's pretty cool. You did it right from your phone, very easy. And you can just do that at text NPNY, and then just put in an amount, whatever that is, and then text that to 74483, and you'll get connected right in. They'll walk you through the steps. If it's your first time, if it's not, then it's going to be a lot easier. So anyway, thank you so much for those you give. You really do make everything happen around here, and we are so excited to see what God is doing because he really is changing lives, and that's neat to be a part of. So let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for just what you're doing. And Lord, when we think of these times and how tough they are, you know, I know we're all struggling. We're struggling through this. You know, some of us are really struggling financially. This has been a real mess. Some of us have struggled with job changes and situation changes. Some of us are going through moves. And every single one of us are dealing with this emotionally. And maybe some of us a little harder than others. So Lord, we are so glad that you are there and you are God. And there's nothing that happens that you are not aware of. And there's nothing that happens to us that we can't bring to you in our struggles. So Lord, as we coming to a new season of the year, as spring approaches, I'm just asking that you give us a renewed sense of joy, of brightness, of wanting to share the joy that's in us because of you. Lord, asking that you would help us break through. Some of us are really struggling through this. Would you help us to break through that already and find that hope and joy that comes from knowing Jesus Christ? So Lord, no matter what our struggles, no matter what the challenges are, Lord, you're there, and that's just amazing. So thank you for the church. Thank you for those who are part of our small group, that are around. Thank you for those we've connected with that we could text or call or feel that we just go hang out with. But most important, that those who are around us that help us to grow in our faith, that are willing to push us a little bit, even maybe a lot, that are challenging us to stay in your word, to pray to you, and that those who pray for us, how neat that is. And thank you for the mission you've given us. And it is so big. And it is so overwhelming to reach the world. So Lord, may we just narrow that down to our little world. The friends in our lives, the family in our lives that need you. So Lord, use this ministry. Use the gifts that come in towards it to allow the ease of being able to have a platform that we can invite people to. A message that they can listen to online or watch online anytime. A place that we can invite them in to be a part of. So that, Lord, not just us, but others around us that we know can have an impact in our life as well. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunities. And thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray in his name. Amen.
And just stand again.
With heaven's sun creation, with pride and adoration, treasures woven by his love. His careful hand they hold us, safe within his promise of calling and of destiny. With heaven's sun creation, pride and
George.
And I'm Jorge, and together we're
George and Jorge.
You know what the world is lacking is a little bit of truth and a little bit of grace. Yeah. So we've taken them both and packaged them together in a really cheesy song that we will all forget in a couple of months and go back to our selfish ways.
Right, right, right. And what we've done is we've remixed the song and we've added in the truth and the grace. So we don't know if you'll live it out, but you can certainly sing it out.
I know the Bible so well, I have some truth I can tell. I know just where you fell, and I can show you the way.
A change in you is my wish, although you tried, you did miss. You must stop acting like this, and I can show you the way.
This truth I'm holding, Jesus' grace I'm showing. Holy Spirit's blowing. Jesus was born as a baby. Hey,
I just met you, and this is crazy. But here's the truth, friend,
and some Gracie.
George and Jorge, you gotta love it, right? Man, what about, those guys are so funny. So we all say it at times, you know, I'm busy, but you know what, I guess I can do it, you know, or please don't be mad, but I don't think I can make it, but maybe I can do things, maybe I can rearrange things, let me just see. Why do we struggle? Why do we struggle saying it? Is it because we want to please others or make others like us or we feel like we want, you know, we need for others to like us? It's that word no. That word no. It's hard to say at times, and sometimes it's harder to say at times more than others. But here are some of the most common reasons why people say no. Okay, and what I want you to do is, okay, close your fists, okay? And you're going to count on your fingers, okay? All these ones that apply to you, okay? Hopefully you don't run out of fingers, okay? Okay, ready? Here's the first one. You fear rejection. That's why you don't say no, because you fear rejection. You're worried that somebody is going to react in a negative way towards you. It might be your boss, because if you don't say yes, then he may fire you. You know what I mean? You don't know. Maybe it's friends will stop being your friends if you say no and you don't go along. Or maybe the kids will think you're not that cool parent. Okay, how about this one? You want people to like you. Okay, bottom line, you just want people to like you. And if you say no, you're afraid, well, maybe they won't like you as much as they should. And so here's the next one. You are compassionate. So be honest. You know, hey, yeah, I'm a compassionate person. I really care. I care about the other people's needs. And so you do it. You just, you know, they ask you and you do it. You say yes most of the time. But here's the thing, you say it so much that it's at the detriment to some of those closest to you, even yourself. You have self-neglect because you're just, I'm just compassionate. Maybe, next one, maybe you feel guilty. Maybe you feel guilty. If you say the word no, there's something inside of you that just makes you feel bad, you know, because you're supposed to help, right? And if I say no, then I'm probably not a good person. And maybe that goes back to your childhood. Your self-worth comes from others. And so when you say no, it's like, no, because I what might others think or what they might they say? And it's hard, you have a hard time seeing your own worth. So you see it in others. You're waiting for their approval. You lack self-love. You lack self-love. You don't feel worthy, and there's something inside. And so by doing these acts of kindness, it just makes you feel good, and somehow it just gives you that sense that, yeah, okay, I'm not such a bad person, right? Sometimes you want something in return, and that's a hard one to admit, but what we do is we do, I'll do this for you, and I'll do this for you, but you're in the back of your mind, or maybe sometimes right in the front of your mind, you're thinking, okay, if I do this, I do this, then they will reciprocate, and when they don't, then guess what, I stop saying yes, you know? So next one, you want to fit in. You want to fit in. So you don't say no because you want to fit in. You feel like, you know, if I'm part of this group, then I'll feel like I fit in. I feel like, you know, and you start, you know, talking a little bit like they do. Maybe you start dressing like they do, and then, you know, you just feel like you fit in. So you don't want to say no. You know, you want to avoid conflict. And some of you guys are really good at, you know, you're conflict avoiders. So you want to avoid conflict. And so it's easier not to say no, because if you say no, then it's going to be like all these things. You have to explain yourself and all this stuff. So it's easier, like, just I'm just not going to do it. So you just say yes, you know. So how did you do? How many of you have any fingers left? Okay. Here's the thing. Maybe, and you may not want to hear this, but maybe here's what it is. Maybe you're a people pleaser, right? You very well could be a people pleaser. Now, the one side is bad, because we don't like that term. We're like, I'm not a people pleaser. You know, nobody makes me do what I want to do. You know, you feel like you're out of control. You feel like you're a wimp. On the other side, there's a good side to it, that you genuinely care for people. You want to help others. And you give of yourself. You're selfless. You just, you know, so there's two sides of this, okay? But before you're too hard on yourself, what I want you to think about, and we don't think about this often, is the number of people connections. Think about that for a moment. The number of people connections. So if there's you, okay, and then if you're married, there's now two of you, okay? So that's one connection, okay? And then if you have kids, you have, you know, one kid or two kid or 15 kids, okay? So that's many more connections. And then if you have, you know, you may have grandkids, if you're a grandparent, you know, so that's more connection. And then there's the rest of your family, okay? Maybe your siblings and all that kind of stuff. And then you have the extended family, you know, your nephew twice removed, but you get together with him, you know. And then think about work. You know, some of you, you know, you work not just one job, but you work two jobs. So think of all those connections. And then think of all those people. So, you know, your coworker you've been working with for a while, and then they have a family, and they tell you about some of their family and some of their kids. And now you're trying to, you know, juggle all that, right? And then you have your friends, right? And then you have your church family, and then you have your clubs or organization, and then you have potential friends. The friends that you're working towards, because as a follower, you're working towards getting to know as many people as possible with the chance you invite them out for coffee, invite them down for dinner, with the chance that one day you will be able to invite them in. So you're investing time to invite them in. So you got all these people. Now, I don't know if you've ever heard of Dunbar. This is Dunbar's theory. His name's Robin Dunbar. He was an anthropologist, British anthropologist. And he had this theory that, well, we all have relationships, okay? We have some that are close, okay? Then we have some that, you know, that's a family and friends. And then you have some that a little bit more on the outskirts. And then you have a little bit more, okay? Some of you have over 500 Facebook friends, okay? The average is actually 338, okay? So some of you are like, oh, I'm below average. Or some of you, you know, it's okay if you have 15, you know. Some of you are like, no, I have like, you know, 1,000. So you have even more friends. If you're in LinkedIn, which is a business kind of a Facebook thing, but anyway, most people on LinkedIn have 500 or more. Okay, so you have a lot of people out there. So Dunbar's theory is this, that we can only maintain about 150 relationships. Now, some of you, that's your family. I mean, if you add an extended family, you're like, okay, we're there, okay? I mean, our pretty much immediate family, my siblings and stuff, we're like 25 or something like that. It's like insane, and now we just keep adding to that number too as they get married. And so that's just that number, right? So 150. So within 150, we have some that are close because we can really only be close to about 3 to 5 people. That's it. So some of you are thinking, well, no, I got like 15 good friends. They're not close then. Because we really can only maintain really, really close, deep, intimate relationships with about 3 to 5 people. Jesus did it. You know, he had Peter, James, and John. Once in a while, there's a couple others that tagged along. He had his 3 close friends. So you have your close friends. Then you have what he calls like the super family, which is like your 15. So that's probably more of your family, possibly, maybe, depending on your family. And then you have your friends, and they fit into like a group of about 15 or so. Okay, then you have your clan. That's the 30. The 35, you have people that you sort of interact with on a regular basis, semi-regular basis, okay? And then you just have the rest, and the rest fall into this bigger picture. But once you get beyond 150, you're out of that. I mean, you just can't do it. I mean, now think about the number of people that you know and all that stuff, okay? And maybe it's well beyond 150, and now you're all thinking, man, I can only really maintain 150? Yeah, because that's all you can remember names usually. Okay, I'm a lot less than that. That's why I love my wife. One of the reasons I love my wife. But she's really good with names. I'm terrible with that, okay? So we're trying to maintain all these relationships, but then think about all the needs, okay? Because just think about your needs, because I know you got a lot of needs, okay? So think about your needs, okay? And then we all feel the pressure of expectations, right? There's those huge expectations. Because if you just think about yourself, for a moment, okay? Not all the time, because then you're a narcissist. But think about yourself just for a moment, and you have to work because you have to pay bills. Okay, so we're dedicated to our company or whatever, or our job or our business. So we're there. And then you should exercise, okay? And then we have to eat. In order to eat, got to go shopping, okay? And then there's the everyday stuff you just do around the house, you know, doing dishes and cleaning and all that kind of stuff. And if you got kids, then you're taking care of kids. If you're married, now there's more stuff. And just think about that for a minute, okay? And then there's mom and dad, okay? And maybe you have to take care of mom and dad because maybe they're older, or maybe it's just maintaining a relationship, you know, and then mom and dad, you know, call you up and say, you know, hey, your niece is celebrating her, you know, her birthday, so it'd be nice if everybody could come down, and now you feel like, okay, we got to go to this birthday party, or, you know, hey, they're doing their little recital, or they're, you know, they're celebrating, you know, third grade graduation. Do we do that? I know we do a lot of graduations anymore, you know. So you feel the pressure of the expectation, and here's the thing, you're a nice person. You want to be a nice person, and that's grace, right? You're grace. You just want to pour out and love on people, right? But the truth is maybe we want others to like us. So welcome back to our series called Truth and Grace. And we love the grace part because that's really cool. We love the whole, you know, where people forgive us, they love on us, all that kind of stuff. The truth part, that's hard. But the thing about Jesus, which was so amazing, is Jesus had the ability to bring the two together. He poured out grace and then he poured out truth. Often when he told the truth, and you see this throughout the Gospels, often when he told the truth, there are a lot of people who walked away. They couldn't handle the truth. But he pours in grace, and then he pours in truth, and when people accept both, and they're ready for both, then he can really work in your life. So in this series, what we learned so far is that Jesus said no. He said, no, I won't be manipulated, okay? There are crowds, they were closing in, they wanted to make him king, and he's like, no, you're not going to manipulate me. It's not my time, right? And so they couldn't get him to do what he didn't want to do. He was not going to be manipulated. Last week we looked and Jesus said, no, I won't meddle. Somebody came up to him and said, hey, will you fix my family problems? We got this disagreement. And he's like, no, that's your mess, right? I mean, he didn't say in those words, but that's basically what he's saying. And he's like, no, you have to work this out. That's not my role. It's not my position. And as you work it out, you'll grow through this, okay? But you have to do this. Today, we're going to look at how can we handle all the needs? How do we handle that expectation pressure? Because all of us feel it. Some of us feel it more than others. Some of us have more connections than others. Some of us have a greater, bigger family or larger family needs. But we feel it. We're going to be looking at the Gospel of Mark. And we're actually going to be at chapter 1. So if you have, you know, the YouVersion on your phone, just link on there. If you're at home, it's easier to grab a Bible because you might have one in the other room or something. Grab a Bible. We're in Mark chapter 1. And we're looking at this. Mark starts out. He says, after John was put in prison, that's John the Baptist, okay, he had been preaching. He gets arrested for telling people the truth, basically what he got arrested for. Okay, he's thrown in jail. It says, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. So Mark begins his gospel primarily with Jesus' ministry in Galilee. So he talks about John the Baptist. He talks about the baptism of Jesus and then going into the wilderness. But after the baptism, after the temptation, Mark jumps right into about a year later into Jesus' ministry. So you have to understand that. There's a time lapse here. And he's skipping the first year of ministry, and Jesus' popularity is growing. And as his popularity is growing, so is the opposition. Because those who are in charge don't like what Jesus is doing, what he's saying. And so there's this tension. And Mark records that Jesus is now going preaching, and he's preaching what? So Jesus went to Galilee preaching the good news, the gospel. And so that's what he's doing. And then Jesus he says, the time has come, he said, and the kingdom of God has come near. This is what Jesus is preaching. He's making two declarations, and these are really important. It's important to understand if you want to follow Jesus, okay? The first one is, the time has come. Now, if you were a Jew, you would understand exactly what that meant because the Old Testament continually predicted that there was going to be a time when the Messiah would come, when the kingdom would start. It would be the time has come for the end of the present age and the beginning of a new age. The time has come. The second is that the kingdom is near. The kingdom is near. So much of the Old Testament is wrapped around the kingdom is coming, the kingdom is coming, the king is going to be here. So get ready. Old Testament prophets, get ready, because the king is coming, the king is coming. The Messiah, they were waiting. Mark's readers, those who are reading his gospel or hearing it as they present it, they knew exactly what Jesus was talking about. The kingdom is near. Why? Because the king is here. And if the king is here, his kingdom is not far behind. So whether he's coming as a conqueror because he is there, because he is present, his kingdom will be coming with him. And then Jesus says this. So he says that the time has come, the kingdom of God is near. And then he says, repent and believe the good news, the gospel. Repent and believe. The Jews that Jesus is talking to, the Jews that now Mark is writing to, needed to respond to what Jesus was saying. And they needed to respond in two ways. The first was repent. Repent literally means to turn from. They needed to turn from what they were thinking, believing, and doing, and they needed to turn towards, to believe. So repent and believe in the good news. The good news, as we understand it, is the king is here and the kingdom is coming, okay? So this idea of repenting and believing, it's a simultaneous event. It doesn't happen like, oh yeah, I'm going to repent, and then you just sort of hang out here, and then, yeah, later on I believe. It's a continuous action. It's I'm repenting from, I'm turning from this, and I'm now believing in and clinging to this. Now, it happens, you know, belief, as we talk about following Christ, that's an action. We, at some point, we get it, and we're like, oh my goodness, I need to turn from this because I'm not going in the right direction. I need to turn to Jesus, and I need to believe in Jesus. And then, as we walk with Christ, there are things in our lives that we say, man, I really got this messed up. Okay, I got to spin that. I got to believe because he has something better in mind, and I got to leave this behind, and I got to leave this behind, and we grow in our following of Jesus Christ. So it's a continual process as a believer, but it's a one-time action to make that time, that moment in time when you believe in Jesus. And so Jesus is challenging them to the good news. I'm here, now repent, same message John was giving, and now believe. All together. It's like this, pretend for a moment you're whitewater rafting, okay? And you're going down this river, and it's like, you know, really one of those rivers, a lot of rapids, okay, and that's why this thing scares me, okay, but you got your life jacket on, you feel like, okay, we're safe even though we're bouncing around, okay, and the boat's, it's just flying down, okay, and you're going pretty fast, and all of a sudden you hit one of those rapids, and you go flying out, okay, that happens, I hear that happens, okay, that's part of whitewater rafting, and I'm like, that's why I won't go, okay, because I'm going to fall out of the boat, I know it. And so you fall out of the boat, okay, and your life jacket, it just flies off, okay? And here you are, you're going down the river a little bit, and then you find a root coming out of a tree, and you grab it, okay? And you're holding on to that for dear life. And the boat, it just keeps going because it's rapids, and it's just gone, you know? And a little while later, they realize, oh, yeah, well, I think we lost one. So, you know, they call in a rescue because they need to rescue you. And so this helicopter comes in, right? It's like you see in the movies. And he comes in because that's the only way they could get you because it's high cliffs and all that. And he comes in, and the guy comes down, you know, the rescue guy. He comes down on a rope with his harness around. And he comes down, and he sees you there, and you're just holding on to this log. You know, like, no, 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 no. Like, I'm good. We'll just stay here. He's like, no, listen, I want to rescue you. I want to save you. So in order to do this, what you need to do is you have to let go of that root, and you have to cling to me. You see, it's a simultaneous action. You can't just let go, because then he's going to be taken down. And he can't hold on to the one rescue him unless you let go. That's what repentance and belief is. It's a simultaneous action that I'm letting go of something I'm clinging to because I think this is the best thing in the world, but now all of a sudden I realize this is better and this will save me. So it's a continuous thing. So then Mark goes on in his gospel, and what he shares is he shares the calling of the first disciples, which is pretty neat because he's talking about first the one who came to serve and then those who are coming to serve the servant, which is pretty cool. And then his ministry is just taking off and news about him spreads. And this is how John writes it. It says news about him, or just how Mark writes it. It says news about him spread quickly over the whole region of Galilee. So Jesus is becoming popular and everyone is going to see Jesus. Even those who oppose him, because they want to see what it's all about. They want to come and, you know, they're the critics. They have to come to these things. But his popularity is growing. Mark then tells the account where After Jesus is teaching for a while, he comes out of the synagogue, and then he gets word that Peter's mother-in-law is sick. And so he goes in and he heals Peter's mother-in-law, okay? That's probably a really cool thing, you know, the mother-in-law is like, wow, you picked the right husband, you know, he has connections, higher-ups, you know? So he goes in, he heals her, and then after that, Mark goes on to share, and he says that evening, so after this event happens, word spreading, right? That evening, after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and the demon-possessed. So word gets out that Jesus can heal people. Hey, he just healed Peter's mother-in-law. So they're bringing the people to him. And Jesus can heal them. He could cast out the demons. And the crowd continues to grow. And it says the whole town gathered at the door. And Jesus healed many who had various diseases. So Jesus goes to work. That's what he does, right? He heals people and he casts out demons. And it says that he also drove out many demons. But he would not let the demons speak, Mark tells us, right? He says, because they knew who he was. And this is in the first account that Mark says this. He says it earlier too, that the demons, and this is so cool when you look at this, because so Jesus has the ability to literally cast a demon that has taken possession of a person. And he's casting demons out. But before that, the demons are like, they're crying out, okay, don't throw us into the pit yet, okay? It's not time, right? And then they cry out and they say, we know who you are, the Holy One. And they use a term that is only designated to God the Father, to Jehovah. Through the Old Testament, this is the words that they use to talk about God. And the demons, they know exactly who Jesus is. And so they're crying out, don't mess with us, God, okay? We're not ready. Like, and so Jesus silences them. He has the power over them. And he silences them because he would not let the crowds take control. He would not let the crowds reveal. He would not let himself be revealed to the crowds before it was the time. He would not let the demons reveal who he was before it was the time. Jesus had to control that thing. So here he is, he's healing people, he's casting out demons. It must be exhausting. And then it says, and early in the morning, Mark records, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, he left the house, and he went away to a secluded place, and he prayed there for a while. Now, I want to ask how many of you got up early, okay, because we all lost an hour of sleep, okay? But Jesus gets up early, and he prays, because he has this continual dependence on the Father. He knows that his strength, that as it gets zapped from, you know, curing and casting out demons, that as it gets zapped, that he needs his Father, and so he goes to his Father. And Jesus not only had the struggle of all the challenges that come from what he did on a daily basis, the teaching, the curing, the demons, but he lived in this tension of knowing what to do in ministry. Because at times, the crowds, and this is where we talked about this a couple weeks ago, the crowds wanted to make him king, but it wasn't his time yet. And the crowds had the ability to, literally, they could have overthrown a government. If they got wild enough, it could have been crazy. But Jesus wasn't his time to be king yet. He was still doing the ministry, and he still had things to do, and the cross had to have happened. So he lives in this tension of how big the crowds get, how bad the tension gets before the time comes when he has to go to the cross. So he wakes up. They wake up, and Jesus is gone, okay? He's gone again. Simon and his companions eagerly search for him. They don't understand his need for prayer. He's just gone, and they're like, okay, Jesus disappeared again. Okay, so they're going out to find him, but eventually they find him. It says, Simon and his companions eagerly search for him, and they found him and said to him, everyone is looking for you. Now, sort of like when, you know, mom hides in the bathroom and locks the door so she just get a little peace, or like the boss or supervisor goes out to the car for lunch just so he'd get away from all the chaos. Okay, Jesus needed time to get away from the chaos. But these words that they are implying are, it's annoyed. They were annoyed. I mean, when they find him, they're annoyed at Jesus because he escaped and he's not there when they need him. I mean, his popularity is growing. And if you were Peter, you'd be like, Jesus, we got the whole day planned, okay? We had a meet and greet set up for 9, and you missed it already, okay? We got the book signing at 12, okay? Then this afternoon, we think you could do a few miracles. If we get any demons, then you can cast those out. And then we want to wrap up the whole day with a nice feed the 5,000 again, okay? So we got this whole thing settled. We're annoyed that you're not around. But see, Jesus knew something that often we miss. There will always be more needs than you can meet. There will always be more. I mean, healing people, that's a good thing. It's a great thing. But there's always going to be more. There's always somebody else that needs help. There's always somebody else that needs to be fixed. There's always another demon to cast out. There's always something else that's going to be pulling at you. And some people you will never meet their needs. You won't. It'll never end. You know, you try to help them, and as soon as you help them with this, then there's another problem, and there's another problem, another problem. There's some people you give advice to, and they don't want to listen because they get it all figured out. And then, you know, a couple weeks later, they're like, you know, I'm just in trouble. Well, you should have listened. You know, they don't want to listen. And there's people that are always going to be needy, and some of you know them. Maybe they're in your life. Maybe they're really close to you, and they're always pulling at you. You see, healthy relationships, they require a give and take. There's a sense where, hey, I could just be myself with you and I could share what's going on. But guess what? You can do the same as well. And yes, in any relationship, there's times when one of you may be going through some rough time for a little bit. But it's a relationship built on mutual give and take. But some, there's always something. It's always, well, my job is a mess, and they complain about that for a while. And then it's the marriage, and then it's the kids, and then it's the cat. And, you know, and you just rewind and it starts all over again, right? And they're the kind of friends that are going to come into your life. And guess what? After a while, you start to catch on. Then no matter what you do, no matter what you say, they're just always going to come into the situation. They're always going to be needy. And guess what? They don't hang around you too often. Because what happens is after a while, you're like, you know, I gave. And it's not helping them at all. And so you pull back. And so guess what? They go find another clan that they can hang out with for another year or two or however long it takes till they wear them out. And Jesus knew the needs will never end. They will never end. So how does Jesus respond to this? How would you respond to this? So he says to them, he says, let's go somewhere else to the nearby towns. Let's go. Can you imagine they're like, what do you mean? Like, we're on a roll here, okay? You're popular. They're bringing more demon possessed. They're bringing more people to be healed. Come on. And if you're like me or, you know, You feel challenged when people are in your life that have needs and you want to help them. You want to, you know, because you generally care and you want to please them. You do. We want to please people. And Jesus had an open invitation to do so much more, to meet so many more needs. But then Jesus said, no, I won't please the people. It's not what I'm here for. I won't give in to your demands. His view of who he was, his value, and his sense of worth did not come from other people. It came from the Father. He did not see himself as one who had to please others. He only had to please one. Now, what possible explanation could you give to want to just leave and go on? So he didn't leave it there. He says this, so that. So that what? Now, whenever you see that, you gotta perk up, okay? So that I'm not just leaving because, you know, I'm tired or anything like that. I'm leaving for Jesus. There was something else. There was something much more important, so important that he could walk away from those who are sick, those who are demon-possessed, even those who are dying. This was more important. And here it is. He says, so that I may preach there. And they're probably sitting there, yeah, but Jesus, like, they're hurting and they're hungry. And, you know, we were going to set up another soup kitchen and we got another clothing drive and we got another, you know, let's just do all this stuff. And Jesus is like, but there'll always be those needs. There's all kinds of stuff and they're great stuff. But I came for one reason. I'm saying no to the good things. I'm saying no to the good things so I can invest in the better things. It's not that these aren't good. It's that I want to focus on the better. Now, there's lots of bad things we can do. Okay, we know that. There's lots of bad things we do. They waste time, they waste energy, they waste money, they cost friendships, okay? There's a lot of things we do that literally waste time, okay? And sometimes we need to. We just need to downtime. You know, you watch a movie, catch up on Netflix, whatever, okay? But some of us, like, if we had a choice, man, we'd just, like, be binging on Netflix and just, like, that's all. You know, I can just veg out. I'll go, you know, hop on my bicycle, or I'll go out to the beach. We can waste a lot of time doing things that are good. We can do a lot of things that are helping other people. But Jesus is saying, we are leaving. We're going to leave, guys. Do you want to come with me? Because we're leaving so I can preach, because that's more important. And then he says this, for this is why I came. This is why I came. I came to preach the good news. Now, why he goes and preaches from town to town, Jesus heals and Jesus cures and Jesus raises the dead and he casts out demons, but he had to keep the main thing, the gospel, the good news. The king is here, the kingdom is near. So what? So repent and believe. Because he wants everyone to know that you can be free. Because we'll always be having this stuff. But what Jesus offers is freedom as a follower of him. And shouldn't, if we're following Jesus, shouldn't our desire to be the same? So we've been given grace, all of us. We've been given grace. Grace is you've been given time. We got time. But see, all of us have the same amount of time, don't we? We all lost an hour of sleep last night, okay? Whether you went to bed early, okay, or you just lost the sleep, okay, we still lost that hour, okay? We don't gain it back till September or something like that, right? One of these days, we'll just get rid of it altogether, right? But we all have the same 24 hours a day. Nobody wakes up and says, oh, I got 30 hours today, or I only got 16. We all have the same 24 hours. We all have 7 days a week. We all have jobs, and we all have bills to pay. We all have family. We all have friends. We all have expectations that are put on us. And Jesus was not saying no to bad things. He was saying no to good things. He was saying this is more important. So the question is, what's your main thing? What's your main thing? You see, if you struggle saying no, okay, what will help is to know your goals. What are your goals? Because if you know what your goals are, then it's easier to say, no, I don't need to do this. I don't need to do this. What is your priorities? Because when we set our priorities, then it's easier to say no to these things because we have our priorities set. We have our goals set. Some of us need to get rid of those toxic people. That literally, they just suck the energy and suck everything out of you. And is that a bad thing? Jesus did it. He walked away. Because there were more important things to do. He wanted to spend time where he could invest in people that were open to listening to him, not just there for the free food or for whatever stuff he could give them. And he invested time in their lives with the hope that he could invite them into his kingdom. That's what we do. We spend time investing so that we can invite. So we invest time with family and friends where we see a little bit of pullback. It doesn't mean we forget everybody else. It just means we spend more time where the message is most received, don't we? So that we can get people to a point in our lives where we've had a few cups of coffee, we've invited them down for dinner, and we've invested time so that now we can say, hey, look, I know church isn't your thing, but we're going to start this new series in a couple weeks, and I really think it would help you guys and some things you've been talking about. Or, hey, our small group, and I know church isn't your thing, but maybe a small group would be, and we hang out together, we love on each other, and we spend some time, we commit to time, and we're going to start this study, and it's on finances, or it's on, you know, it's on raising kids, or whatever like this, and I, you know, I think you guys would get a lot out of it. Why don't you come, and I'll ask the group, and we love to have new people, That's what we do. That's grace and that's truth. We need both. We need both. Because if we only get grace, we're only getting part of it. And if we only get truth, that's pretty harsh. So we need both. And Jesus called us as followers to an amazing calling that we can be loved by a God who loved us so much that he left his place that was so comfortable to come and walk among us. To a God who loves you so much that he died for you. He went to a cross so that we could understand what it means to repent and believe. And what Jesus' hope is this, is that as we do that in different areas of our lives, that why it becomes easier is because our belief level goes up. Because we see God working in a way that we're like, wow, now that I see that, it's easier to let go of this. But we only see that when we let go. It's the catch-22. You have to let go in order to see. And then the more you see, the more it's easier to let go of other things. So maybe you're here today, and you know, maybe you gave your life to Christ a long time ago, and maybe the thing that we need to be reminded of today was this, that we need to invest in people's lives. Because the most important thing is not whether we can fix their car, we can take them to take them to this place or that, or we can help them with their yard or whatever. The most important thing is we can help them to understand the gospel. If they're a believer, we're helping them grow. If they're not yet a Christian, a follower of Christ, we're helping them to get to that point. Maybe today's the day you need to make that decision to believe, to repent and believe. And we, the church, that's what we're here for. We're here to help you grow. And we're here to help you find Jesus. And we're here to help you find the one who loves you so much. And his love is bigger than anything you've ever done. It's greater than any view that you have of yourself. He loves you. And that is our priority, isn't it? The message. Father, thank you so much for Jesus Christ. Thank you so much that he came. That he had the guts to live his life full of priorities. To leave behind things that are not as important as the message. So Lord, I'm asking right now for wisdom. Because all of us are struggling with that. Every day we struggle with that wisdom. Of how to know when. And how to know who. Lord, there are people in our lives, there are things in our lives that are drawing us away from what's most important in our life, and that's you. So Lord, help us to refocus, to set higher priorities, and to be used by you to carry a message to a world who so needs it. Lord, to those who may have grasped it for the very first time today, may they find the peace that comes from knowing Jesus Christ. May they realize how much he did on the cross for them. That he died for everything they ever did bad. So that they could have new life. So Lord, thank you for grace. Because that's grace. That you love us. Even in our sin, you love us. And the truth that, Lord, we need to repent. We need to turn towards you. That you may renew us. Thank you, Lord, for Jesus Christ. And we pray in his name. Amen.
I bring my knee, I will bring my heart.
Hey, what a great way to wrap up today. So thanks for coming. Thanks for being with us. I hope you share this link because people can watch it during the week. And we'll see you next week as we continue our series. So have a great week. Enjoy it.
Supposed to be. There's a war that's raging over me.